Hi all. Today we'll be discussing about Zookeeper. So Zookeeper is an Apache open source project for handling like the coordination and synchronization in distributed applications. So I'm just So this is an open source project. So it's free to use. Source. And it is in Apache also. So the name Zookeeper means like the distributed application, the managing distributed applications, like it is like a zoo actually. So that is the reason actually the name Zookeeper came. So you can see like Zookeeper is being used in like a lot of projects, like in Apache Yarn, like the Hadoop second generation Yarn, then the second generation Hadoop, like the Yarn, then Storm it is being used, then in HBase Zookeeper is used. Lot of projects actually Zookeeper, like lot of projects are actually using Zookeeper. So we will actually go through, get into the more details about Zookeeper. So we will go one by one. So first we will be discussing what is Zookeeper. So before that we can discuss before getting into Zookeeper we can discuss. So what are the challenges faced by distributed applications? Challenges faced by distributed application, then need for a framework like Zookeeper. Then what is Zookeeper? Then we'll be discussing internals of Zookeeper. Then we'll discuss about modes of operations. Then we'll discuss the installation of a small setup. Then interacting with Zookeeper. So we can interact in several ways. We will discuss the ways in this part. So we'll cover actually almost all the details about Zookeeper in these topics. So first we'll start with the challenges faced by distributed application. So in the previous sessions you might have discussed about the scalability, the way we scale systems. So one is actually horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. So vertical scaling means you discussed. So basically we have two types of scaling. So one is horizontal scaling and another is vertical scaling. So horizontal scaling means we are increasing the capacity of the system by adding more nodes to the existing system. So one is vertical. I'll draw that. Scaling. So how to scale systems and adding more. So in case of vertical scaling, so suppose if we have 1 GB system, 1 GB RAM system, so later actually your processing requirement increased, so you will replace the 1 GB RAM system with a bigger system, 4 GB RAM system. So you will be replacing the existing system. So you will replace this and you will put a 4 GB machine, GB and 10 core, something like that you will increase. So here again, if this 4 GB is not for helpful, then you will replace it with a high-end machine. So like that, if we scale systems like this, it will be called vertical scaling. So this is vertical scaling. And horizontal scaling, so in case of horizontal scaling, the distributed processing and the storage will come. So in case of horizontal scaling, suppose if you have 1 GB system and you found later after some time you found this cannot satisfy your need, so you will add one more system again with some similar configurations or more configuration to the system. It's not replacing, it is actually adding more nodes. Again system, again another system, and you will actually create a cluster out of this. You will create a cluster, like you will create a cluster out of this. So here actually like multiple machines will interact with each other. So this is actually finally this will become a group of systems. So and in a group of systems, it will be like there will be some communications between all the systems. All the systems will communicate each other. So but there are some challenges associated with the distributed system processing, because distributed storage and processing, it has its own advantages that like we are not replacing the system, and like the cost of scalability, it will be less. All like with this advantages also, there are some challenges. Challenges means basically like we are dealing with multiple systems. So the synchronization between these systems, so the main challenges. So challenges in distributed systems. So like horizontal scaling leads to distributed systems, and the challenges in distributed system, main challenge is synchronization. Coordination, etc. Like we can go synchronization or coordination. Then another is like partial failure. I will explain all these things. So synchronization, coordination, coordination, like partial failure, all these are actually like some bigger challenges, big challenges in case of distributed systems. So synchronization means, suppose like we have four machines. So for every like when a client request, or for every processing, these machines should be in sync. Like each one should know like what I have to do, and like what others, like the health of other machines. So suppose like you are giving actually a big chunk of work, and it went into these machines in small pieces. Like this machine got this much, and after the processing, like all these machines should process this much part and should send back the details properly. And again, if one of these machines got failed, it should be communicated properly. The entire system should know this machine got failed. If they are not knowing this thing, finally they end up in the job failure. So like all these things actually we can't actually like tolerate in case of our distributed systems actually. So we need actually some mechanism to like make this distributed systems robust. So we need a coordination framework properly. So I'll tell you an example. So suppose you are actually a client. So you are a client and you have four servers. You have four servers. So the condition is like at any point of time I can communicate to any of these machines. S1, S2, S3, S4. At any point, and this is the client. The thing is, at any point of time, the client can communicate to any of these four servers. The only requirement is, while the client communicates to the servers, that particular server should be available. That is the condition. So suppose if a client try to communicate to this server, if this S3 is not up, it will be a problem. So my condition is, at any point when I can communicate to any of these four servers, and at the time of communication that server should be up. That is my condition. So if this is the requirement, and what we'll do, so like the possible solutions are like we can keep the status of these nodes. We can keep the status of these four nodes. Here actually we will assign another person, or we will call like watcher. So watcher will actually check, watcher will check the status of, we'll assign watcher to check the status of the servers, and the client will first check with watcher whom I can communicate with. Then after that the client will get, so the client will get the list of, the client will get the list of proper servers or the available servers from a watcher, and watcher will continuously or periodically get the status from the servers, so that he, like he will be having a list maintained with all the running servers. But again there is a problem. What happens if the watcher dies? So again, what happens if the watcher itself actually dies? Again the possibility of failure is there. So like watcher, actually we can't trust watcher even if you keep actually high end hardware, any type of hardware. So we can't trust the watcher because it is again a machine. Anything can happen to hardware actually. So if the watcher dies, what happens? Again we will be in trouble. So this is one problem. So another problem is like, suppose, so like we will park this problem actually, we will discuss the like final solution later. But we actually found a solution, but that solution has a problem. Like if the watcher dies, we found a solution about watcher, but that watcher has a problem. If the watcher dies, again that solution will be like, it will not work out. So I am giving you another example. We have two machines, or else like two persons. Yeah, like two machines or persons, you can actually assume anything. So suppose you and your friend are on a call. So you and your friend are on a phone call, this one, and you both are communicating with each other. So like your communication happens over the network, so that is for sure, right? So your communication happens over the network, and you and your friend are talking continuously. So your, so like suppose M1 is one person, M2 is another person. M1 communicates to M2, M2 communicates to M1, so like that. So suppose M1 is continuously talking to M2, M1 is continuously talking to M2. In the meantime, so we don't know at what time, but in the meantime what happened was M1 was continuously talking to M2 and M2 was talking to M1. In the meantime actually the network went down. Network went down. So but M1 was like not knowing this thing, and M1 was again talking to M2, because M2 was actually just here listening to what M1 was saying. So M1 was talking continuously to M2, and meantime the network went down. So M1 realized the network failure after some time only. M1 realized the network failure after some time only. After that M1 don't know actually at what time or at what point of his conversation the network failure happened. So M1 doesn't have any idea about the network failure, like at what time or at what point of time so the network failure happened. So like so he don't know like what M2 got from his end, what all things M2 got from his end. So this is actually a network failure, and here like the communication, the M1 is not able to complete his communication. So his communication or conversation, the conversation actually got failed at the middle, and they were not knowing, like M1 don't know actually what happened or what is actually what reached M2. So this we can actually tell something like a partial failure. Partial failure means we don't know the status. It's not actually the conversation, like that communication was not complete, and it is not actually zero also. So it is actually in the middle of zero, like of complete and incomplete.
It's not complete ideally, it's like it's in the middle of actually in complete state. So M1 don't know the completion status. So that is actually something partial. So this is again actually another problem with distributed systems. So if some communications, like instead of people talking to each other, you can actually link it with some machines talking to each other in a distributed system. In that case, if some failure happens in the meantime, so what happens? The first machine not know what actually reached the other machine, and they will be in a confused state, or like they will be in an unknown state. So this kind of partial failure is a major problem in case of distributed system. So we have to find proper coordination, or we need a proper coordination and synchronization between the systems in case of distributed systems. So for that purpose actually we need a framework. So that is what actually we have Zookeeper. So that is what we discussed, what are the challenges faced by distributed applications. So like writing, the main challenge while writing a distributed application is managing the coordination and managing the partial failures. So if we have something that can deal with the partial failure and coordination, so then it will be very great. So that like the developers can actually concentrate more on writing the logics or writing the remaining use cases with the distributed systems. So like the Zookeeper will take care of this coordination. So that is actually the we discussed like the challenges and the need for a Zookeeper. So but we didn't discuss actually what is the solution for this. This is actually the need for Zookeeper. So here actually in the first case we discussed like the watcher dead. So what will happen actually, what will be the solution in the first case? So in the second case we said partial failure happened. So what will be the solution? So what we can do is, instead of keeping a single watcher, if we give assign, like we can assume like watcher as a watchman, we can assign a group of machine for watcher. We can assign actually a group of machine for watcher. So in this case what happens, the communications will, like even if one machine fails, the other machine will be available. Instead of keeping a single watcher, we will keep a group of machines in a watcher. Then in this case, even if a single machine fails, suppose this got failed, again we have another set of two machines running in the group. So this will solve the single point of failure. So here we got a solution. So if we have a clustered set of watcher or something actually that coordinates the communication without a single point of failure, that will help. So that like it will always maintain the track of these distributed systems, and the client can confidently communicate to the nodes. The client will always get the updated. So suppose like these servers S1, S2, S3, S4, this will communicate to this cluster and says I am up. And this cluster will, like this watcher will have a list which has all the running servers, and that list will be updated every time. And when client communicates, client will get the list of running nodes and it will communicate to the proper running nodes only. So this is actually one solution. Similarly here, here actually the network failure happened and the clients don't know actually at what point of time it got failed. So here also, if we keep someone in between, a watcher in between this, and if the communication, if we keep a track or maintain a track of the communication between these two in the watcher, if a third person knows the communication, so if like all the communications between M1 and M2, if we are keeping a track, if we are maintaining a track in the watcher, Like if you are simply communicating without any intermediate person, it will be a risk. So if we are maintaining a track in the watcher, then what happens? This watcher knows at what point the communication failed. So if simply direct communication happens, means we don't know at what point the communication fails. But if this watcher is there, so watcher will maintain a track of what communications happened between M1 and M2, and it will know actually at what point the communication from M1 to M2 or M2 to M1 failed. So this will actually help us to avoid partial failures. So we will know actually at what point of time or else actually what all things actually the what all communications happened between these machines. So similar to this, there are actually n number of like use cases and algorithms, algorithms actually inside Zookeeper. So that will actually help distributed applications to sustain like partial failures and synchronization problems. So that like developers can actually easily they can actually concentrate more on developing their application instead of wasting time for solving the problems with the distributed systems. So this is actually a brief introduction about the challenges faced, requirement for Zookeeper, and challenges faced and the requirement for Zookeeper, and how actually the coordination framework can help in synchronizing these problems, or else actually avoiding this, help in avoiding these problems. So now we can actually discuss, right now we discussed about the scenarios, where we need actually this coordination frameworks and all. So now we can discuss more about Zookeeper actually. What is Zookeeper and all? So Zookeeper is a coordination framework. So it actually maintains, provides synchronization, coordination, etc. to distributed systems, and it handles actually partial failure. It will not avoid partial failures, but it will handle partial failures properly. So I'll just draw an architecture diagram of a Zookeeper. Zookeeper. So first thing is Zookeeper has two modes of running actually. Modes of operation. So the modes of operation we will discuss. So one is it can run in a standalone mode. So one is standalone mode. Second is the clustered mode. So this we can call as replicated mode also. We'll call it replicated mode. So it is the clustered. So clustered mode, standalone mode actually it will be a single machine. So in case of standalone mode, so we'll be here, it's a single machine. And this one not for production use. It's a single machine, not for production. Standalone mode, it will be Zookeeper will be running in a single machine and not be used for production purpose. Then no high availability. And this can be used only for testing and development actually. While developing any applications and all, if you don't have multiple machines, you can proceed with a single machine. So that is actually standalone mode. So clustered mode actually we'll be having multiple Zookeeper, multiple machines. So we have multiple machines. We'll be having multiple machines. HA, high availability will be there, used in production. So this is actually the real mode in which Zookeeper runs in production actually. So replicated mode. So these are the two modes of operation of Zookeeper. Then
What is actually inside a Zookeeper? So what exactly, like we discussed, like Zookeeper provides a lot of coordination on, it is highly available, it's high performance application, it is very fast, all those things. But what is inside, or inside Zookeeper? What is inside Zookeeper? So that is actually like what we need to understand actually. So what is inside Zookeeper? Or like it is a, what is actually the basic funda behind a Zookeeper? So Zookeeper is nothing, it is actually just a file system. Zookeeper is just a internally, like while thinking, like while viewing from the backend part, Zookeeper, we can see like it is just a file system. You can see a lightweight file system. It is distributed and like it will be having a tree structure. File system distributed. Distributed in nature. And will be having a tree structure. So this is actually, and like you can, yeah, this is actually what is inside a Zookeeper. It's a lightweight file system and is distributed in nature and will be having tree structure. So tree structure means just like the Unix file system. So we have like slash, again we have like slash root, slash var, like that. Actually, like again, if something is inside slash root, it will be something like slash root slash test. Something inside slash root slash test, it will be something like slash root slash test slash abc. So the file system goes like this. So where, if something inside var, select like var log, so it will be like a tree structure. It will maintain a tree structure. So this Zookeeper also has a file system that will follows this tree structure. So distributed in nature, distributed in nature means like we discussed Zookeeper, like the production mode of Zookeeper, like it consists of multiple machines or multiple nodes. So distributed nature means it replicates this file system across multiple machine, so that like even if one machine goes down, the replica of the file system will be available in remaining machine. And replication factor in this case, it will be like it's same as like it will be like as many number of machines, it will be replicated across all the machines. Suppose if you have three machines, 1, 2, 3, if we store this tree structure, it will be the same replica will be present in all the three machines. So that is why distributed in nature means it will, the file system, the replication, the file system will be replicated across all the machines. And like if you think about a file system, you may think like I can store any data or any saved data in that file system. It is not like that. So you will not be able to store any huge file system file inside that Zookeeper. So there is a limit, like we can store only like some particular, until some particular amount. It will be in the range of some maximum of some MB and all. So we can store in a, it depends on the inode and all. So by default actually one inode can store, it's not inode actually, EZ node can store only a maximum of 1 MB. The default value that an EZ node can store is actually 1 MB. So EZ node is actually like, just like in Linux we have the inodes. Just like that we have nodes in the tree structure. So this is a slash root is a node, slash root slash test is another node, slash root slash test slash ABC is another EZ node, like that. So each EZK node can store actually a maximum of 1 MB. So that is what, so each EZK node, so these are actually EZK nodes, like slash root is one EZK node, slash root slash test is another node. So each EZK node can store some particular amount of data and it can have actually child nodes also. So the maximum data that can store in an EZK node is like it will be 1 MB. So only thing that Zookeeper guarantees is it, this file system will be highly available. Whatever we store here, it will be highly available. It can withstand failures. So whatever we store in this file system, it will be highly available. So like if this acts as the intermediate watcher, so this watch Zookeeper
So if we put zookeeper as an intermediate, as a mediator or someone between so it maintains, like if these machines writes, so if we keep zookeeper in between this communication, so if we keep zookeeper in between this communication, so it will be like zookeeper will keep a maintain a track of this. So if we keep zookeeper in between this communication, zookeeper will keep a track of this communication. So like at the end actually we'll be having a robust communication between this client and the server, this clusters. So till now we discussed like zookeeper in a like we show I showed zookeeper in a box. So what like how the zookeeper looks like. So zookeeper actually like in production we use zookeeper in clustered or replicated mode. So there will be multiple machines associated with a zookeeper cluster. So like suppose I'll put three nodes currently. So and this has a zookeeper cluster. So there will be like we can call these machines like Z1, Z2 and Z3. So we have three machines, Z1, Z2 and Z3. So and we can call this entire setup as a zookeeper cluster. So zookeeper, as I discussed, zookeeper internally has a file system. So the clients can communicate to the zookeeper, so it can read. So the clients can communicate to the zookeeper client. So it can communicate to the zookeeper. So what all things it can do? So it interacts with the zookeeper cluster. So what it can do is either it can read data from the file system. So it can read, write, delete. Can do read, write and delete operations in this file system actually. So like anyway, append it's not supported. So append or edit, it's not actually supported. So update is possible, but update means like it's like erasing the existing data and writing new. It's not like adding new data to the existing one. It's like if you want to write some data again, it will delete the existing data. And like suppose if you want to write some data to the Z node ABC, so it will write the if you write something, it will delete, it will clear the data associated with the ABC first. It will clear the data associated with the ABC first, then it will write the new data to the ABC. Suppose if you want to write something here, it will clear first and it will write again. So that is what happens. So there is no append operation associated with zookeeper file system. It will read, write and delete. So basically read, write and delete. So a client can read, a client can write or can delete. And all these things are actually governed by the ACLs associated with the file system. So just like any ACLs means access control list. ACLs means access control list. So all the access to this file system, it is governed by the access control list associated with the inode. It's not inode, it's Z node. So this client, it can communicate to either Z1 or Z2 or Z3. It can communicate to any of the three machines. So right now we have three machines. So if you look into more details about zookeeper cluster, so among the machines, one machine will be the leader. So I'll draw this image in a little bigger way, larger way. So we have machine one, machine two,
have machine 3. So, and we have client. We have client. So a client can communicate to machine 1 or machine 2 or machine 3. So, and among the zookeeper cluster, one of the node will be a leader. Suppose in this entire cluster, if we keep leader and the remaining will be followers. Right now, yeah, followers. So one machine will be leader and remaining will be followers. This will be actually like this election will like this leader will be chosen randomly. It is based on an election. So any machine can become a leader. So all these machines will be having voting rights, and one machine will become the leader and remaining will become the follower. So all the followers, actually, like when a client communicates to any of the, like a client can communicate to a leader or follower. There is no rule like client can communicate only to leader or client can communicate only to follower. So a client can to a or follower. A client can communicate to a reader, a leader or a follower. When a client communicates to a leader or like suppose if a client communicates to a follower and a client can read, do read or write operations follower, read, write or delete operations with the leader or follower. So if read operation happens, means nothing happened, no modifications. If read happened, read operation happened means not a modification happened to the file system. To zookeeper file system. If read operation happened means no modification happened to the zookeeper file system. So like no need to broadcast to any of every node. But if write or delete, in case of write or delete, it means some modification happens. So like I said, like all these nodes will be having the same copy of file system. It will be replicated across all these machines, same copy replication. So if this is F1, this will be again same as F1, this will be again same as F1. So all the three machines like will be having the same copy of file system. So if any modification happened to any of this machine, it has to be broadcasted or it has to be replicated across all the machines. So if suppose client communicated to the follower, first machine, so and it did a modification, so what the remaining thing will happen is like if some modification happens, it'll the follower will report back, report to the follower will report the modification to the leader. The follower will report the modification to the leader. He'll say like some modification happened to me. Some modification happened to me. And this leader will broadcast the modification to all the nodes. Leader will broadcast the modification to all the nodes. So like client connected to F1, like not F1, the follower 1, machine 1, and some modification happened here. So after the modification, what happened? Like it will contact the leader. Leader will actually broadcast the modification to all the nodes. Like currently it is like this one is the 3 node cluster, so it will broadcast to only like these 3 machines. So this modification, so now it will be like F1 dash, file system will become F1 dash, it will be F1 dash, and this will be F1 dash. So the file system, like, it will be updated to the modified file system F1 dash. It will be replicated across, ideally, like, it should be replicated across all the machines. Ideal case, so it will become F1 dash everywhere. So this is the way Sukiparam works. So, like, instead of the first machine, if the client communicated to this one, instead of this, so the client communicated to the follower 3, follower, like, the last machine, the second follower. Again, some modification happened here. It will contact the leader, and leader will broadcast it to all the machines. Since we have only, like, one extra machine, leader will keep it inside the leader itself, and leader will apply the modifications in the same machine as well as in the remaining machines. And so this is actually, like, the way Zookeeper works. So, like, a block diagram, like, it will be something like this. So this will be, like, it can have multiple servers. So one will be leader and remaining machines will be followers. N number of clients can communicate to any of these nodes. I'll take this picture out. So this picture, it shows, like, server. We have 5 servers, and we have, like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 clients. So these clients are actually, clients can communicate to any of these nodes. After the communication to the individual server, the modification happens here, and it will communicate to the leader first. Leader will broadcast the modifications to all the remaining nodes. So similarly, like, in case of other clients also, here, like, this client contacted this server, the operation happens here, and it will broadcast the changes to all the remaining nodes. So, like, this is the architecture. So, like, this is the leader and remaining are the followers. So this server 1, server 2, server 4 and server 5, these are actually the followers, and this is actually the leader. And leader actually, like, it is decided, like, there is, like, when we install the Hadoop, like, the Zookeeper cluster, we will not define, like, this one, like, the first one or third one is actually the leader and remaining are the followers. So it will be randomly deciding the leader and follower. One among the entire Zookeeper cluster nodes will be leader, and remaining will be the followers. So it happens based on an election, leader election. So the leader election happens internally, and it is based on some particular. So the leader and followers are decided based on election. So leader will be randomly elected. It's actually, like, one election will happen between this, all these machines, and leader will be decided, like, which machine is leader. All those things will be decided. So, like, we discuss, like, leader, followers, voting. So this is based on voting. The leader election is, the leader is decided based on voting an election. Election leader is decided based on an election, and all this, like, nodes have this voting rights. So, like, there are some machines which will not be having any voting rights, that we'll discuss later. So, right, as of now, assume, like, all the machines in this cluster has voting rights. So I am not putting like that, I am just putting voting rights. So this followers, like the group consisting of followers and the leader, that machine group, all these machines will be having voting rights, and these machines will vote and find out a leader. So suppose if in the middle of this operation, if the leader fails, if in the middle of this operation, if this leader fails, in this middle of this operation, this leader fails, so what happens? Again, one leader election will happen automatically, and it will figure out another leader. So one node will be chosen as the leader. Again, like suppose this can be a leader. This will be the leader and remaining will be the followers, like that. So election will again happen and remaining machines will follow the machine. So and like this leader election is actually very fast. Election very fast, and so it will not actually affect the client operations and all. Leader election is very fast, like it will be in the range of milliseconds. Leader election is very fast, it will happen in the range of milliseconds. Like usually it happens like the calculations are showing like it usually happens with less than 200 milliseconds and all leader election. So the entire leader election process, so that process means like first the leader will be elected and it will be synchronized with all the followers. So that will be the entire leader election process, that process actually, that stage, that phase. So the entire phase, it is like the leader election phase. The election phase is like, it will be, it includes leader election plus synchronization between with the followers. So this entire thing happens again in less than in few milliseconds. So like it will be in the range of some milliseconds. So suppose like it will happen in, anyway it will happen in less than seconds. So it will be it is very fast. So this is actually the leader election phase. First the leader will be elected and the remaining machines will report to the leader. So this is actually the phase. So it will happen in milliseconds. So this is leader election. So Zookeeper, we discussed about election, leader election. So leader election, like it will be the election will be finalized, the election time will be finalized like once the election plus election, the time for time taken for the election plus for the time taken for the synchronization with the followers. So this is actually like about election. So Zookeeper uses a protocol, like the basic idea behind, the basic working principle behind Zookeeper is like it has a file system, we discussed already. So it has a file system and this file system will be replicated across nodes, or majority of the nodes. Because like it may not be always possible to replicate the same thing across all the nodes, because sometimes some nodes may fail or sometimes the network may be having some problems. So just to avoid all those issues, so what Zookeeper will do is it will consider the majority. So like it has a file system and it the file system will be replicated across the majority of the nodes. So for achieving this, Zookeeper uses a protocol called ZAB. So Zookeeper uses a protocol called ZAB actually for achieving this operation, like for achieving the replicated file system. So it has actually two phases. One is leader election and another is atomic transactions. Atomic transactions. So one is the leader election and another is the atomic transactions. So this will always also known as atomic broadcast. So we can like call it as atomic broadcast or transaction. So these are the two phases in SAP. So leader election we already discussed, like out of the n number of nodes in Zookeeper, one node will be taken as the leader and remaining will be the followers. So let's just like as of now actually consider the leader and followers. Later we'll discuss actually about one more member, so that we'll discuss later. So as of now consider leader and followers. So leader election will happen, and another is actually atomic transactions. So like in a zookeeper cluster, so another thing is zookeeper cluster is also known as like ensemble. Cluster of nodes, which so the zookeeper cluster is also known as ensemble. So the rule in zookeeper cluster, like zookeeper, is that the file system should be replicated to the majority of the nodes in ensemble, to the majority of the nodes in the ensemble. This is actually what happens in zookeeper. Majority of the nodes in the ensemble. So majority of the nodes means like and so there is one more rule, like in the number of nodes in zookeeper actually. So how will calculate majority? So like suppose like zookeeper, so we discussed like it can handle actually some node failures in ensemble, the cluster. That is the reason actually we are putting more than one node in the zookeeper cluster, just to have high availability. So suppose we have one node. So in this case what happens? One node failed, no HA. So second case we have two node. One failed, what happens? Then remaining is one failed, one running. So this is like there is no majority. So it will always choose actually the rule is always based on majority. So here actually one failed means there is no majority. One failed, one running, both are equal. So two node also will not help HA. Three node zookeeper cluster. Three node, one failed. So in this case we have two running. So this will be one failover. So HA will work. So again we have two running, one failed. So we have actually a majority of two, minority of one. So number of running nodes is greater than number of dead nodes. So HA, the fail will still withstand because it is having the majority. In three node, if two failed, in that case what will happen? Only one running. Here what happens? So sorry, in case of two node it will not, no HA. So okay, so here what will happen? It will not withstand, it will fail. Then we'll have four node. Consider four node. One failed. Still we have three running. So it is highly available. It's available. Four nodes. Two failed, two running. So here when you calculate the number of failed nodes and running nodes, it will be equal. So no majority, it can't withstand, it will fail. Again four nodes, three failed, one running, fail. Five nodes, one fail, for running available, highly available five nodes two fail three running again three running is majority compared to two failed so highly available it's available it will be available it's like again that also it will withstand nodes three fail two running again three fail two running means it will be minority so it will fail so if you just see this one it will not be having any HI it can't withstand any failover two also it can't withstand any failover three it can handle one failover one machine one node failure so one node failure so again four node it can handle only one so if I do like this one node can handle only zero two node can handle only zero failures machine failures three node it can handle one four node it can handle only one five node can handle two similarly six node also if you calculate like this it can handle only two seven node can handle three eight node can handle three so from this mathematics we can see right keeping an odd number of zookeeper instances will not help you will not like serve you much so if like regarding the failure machine failure because if any of the instance in the zookeeper cluster fails the fail like it will still withstand up to some number so if you keep odd number of if you are keeping even of even number of instances it will not help you because it can only provide the same number of failovers or it can only withstand actually the same number of failures as that of the corresponding odd number so means 3 and 4 even if 3 and 4 can withstand only one 5 and 6 both the 5 and 6 keeping 6 nodes also gives only like it will withstand only two failures so there is no point in keeping one more additional machine so usually we keep odd number of zookeeper instances in a cluster so I'll tell you actually the case when we use more than that but usually in a zookeeper cluster we will keep odd number of zookeeper instances this is the reason for that because keeping even number will not actually from the failure perspective like failure withstand perspective there will not be any gain in keeping even number of instances but I'll talk to you like I'll tell you one thing actually regarding the scalability for scalability case actually we will keep more nodes but that we will discuss later but from the failure withstand perspective actually like we will not like there is no advantage in keeping even number of zookeeper instances so this is actually about the number of zookeeper instances the like how we define the number of zookeeper instances and all so like for at least for so for in clustered mode actually we need at least a minimum of 3 nodes so we will consider zookeeper in a clustered mode only if like if we have a minimum of 3 nodes because less than 3 nodes will not help you that will again actually it cannot withstand even a single failure of any of the machines in the cluster so a zookeeper cluster means it should ideally have at least 3 nodes so we usually have keep like 3 5 7 like that so a production cluster should have a zookeeper cluster which should have a minimum of at least 3 nodes and another thing zookeeper will not be a like heavy process so you can keep this zookeeper running in any of the existing nodes in the cluster so you don't have to dedicatedly give like you don't have to dedicate some specific machines to zookeeper so we can actually use the existing machines like it is actually a lightweight service it is not actually a heavy like resource like heavy resource requirement service so this is regarding the number of nodes so next thing is like I discussed like zookeeper uses a protocol called zap and it contains two phases, leader election, atomic transactions or atomic broadcast. So atomic broadcast, so again rod like transaction will be, it can be like, it will be atomic transaction or broadcast. So we know what is leader election. One among the machine will be elected as a leader and remaining will be the followers. So leader will guide the, leader will meet the, so like a client can connect to any of the lead, any of the nodes in the Zookeeper cluster. So I'll put the picture again. This slide will be shared across you. So this picture I am again copying again. So a client can connect to any of the server in the Zookeeper cluster. It can be a follower, it can be a client, so it can be like anything. Like one more node is there, again observer, I'll discuss that. So it can be a like leader or follower. So once a client makes a read request means no change happens in the file system. Read means no changes happens in the file system. So that is fine. So that doesn't need any replication across the machine. But if a client makes any write request means if this client made a write request to this follower, what happens? Some modification will happen to the file system. So we know actually this file system is replicated, the same file system is replicated across all these machines. So if some changes happens here, it has to be replicated across all the machines. So what this server will do is, this server will forward the transaction to this leader. It will forward the transaction. First the client, the follower receives the request, it will forward it to the leader, and leader will broadcast that to the majority of the servers. So we have here, we have actually totally of 5 servers, and out of 5 server, 4 are actually the followers and 1 is actually the leader. So this will be broadcasted across all the machines. So finally all these 5 machines will be having, ideally all these 5 machines will be having the same copy of the file system. But Zookeeper actually gives a rule, like if the majority reaches, like if this update reaches the majority of the machine, it is considered actually it is a valid update, because once actually the server forwards it to the like the follower forwards it to the leader, and leader sends broadcast it to everyone, and if the broadcast happens successfully with the majority of the nodes means out of this, like suppose we have actually 5 out of 5, actually if it got broadcasted to like 3 successfully properly, it means actually like it is actually a valid update. So once it is broadcasted to majority of the nodes, the leader will consider that update as a valid update and it will commit that update. So once the leader commits that update, then the client will get a response like it is a successful write. So once a client makes any write request, it can communicate to either follower or leader. If it is communicating to any of the follower or leader, the leader, if it is a follower, it will broadcast it to the leader. It will actually forward the request to leader, and leader will broadcast across all the machines. So once the leader broadcasts it to every machine, it will wait for the status from individual instances, and if the update happened in majority of the servers, the leader will consider it as a successful transaction. So follower or leader gets from client, I am just putting it in words, request from a client forwards, if it is a write request, it forwards to leader, if majority
zeroed out the nodes. Full leader commits success, response will be given to client. This is again the operation.
So this is actually atomic. So if it is, either it can be a success, this write operation, either it can be a success or it can be a failure. So there is no intermediate state in between success or failure. So if it is not, suppose if the leader broadcasts to all these nodes and if it is not reaching the majority, it will consider it as a failure. So either it can be success or it can be a failure. So the operations are, the broadcasts are actually atomic. It is actually atomic means it has only like predefined pakka states. So it can be like, that is the reason we call us atomic broadcasts. So like we explained about two things. One is leader election and election, the two phases of SAP protocol: leader election, atomic broadcast. Atomic broadcast. So these are the two important phases in the SAP protocol. So then another topic regarding this zookeeper is like how to achieve scalability. So suppose suppose in this case we have 5 servers. So if your requirement, if the number of clients connecting to this, suppose like right now we have only like 8 lines. So suppose if something comes like more number of clients want to connect to this service, so what we will do, we will increase the number of nodes in the zookeeper cluster. So zookeeper cluster means again the number of followers increases. So in the normal way, if you are thinking, one machine will be leader and remaining machine will be the followers. So for scalability, if you increase the number of nodes, scalability solution is increase number of nodes. So if you increase number of nodes, the election will become tight, because more number of like one leader, we have like the concept of one leader, remaining followers. If we go with this concept, what happens? If we increase the number of nodes, the number of followers will be more, and the number of nodes in the election, increases, number of voting nodes increases, then number of nodes who keeps file system replica increases. So if the number of nodes who keeps the file system replica increases, the problem is if leader broadcasts something, it has to reach all the nodes. Suppose if we increase it to 10, if leader broadcasts anything, it has to be broadcasted to all the 10 nodes. And again, with the 10 nodes, the problem is like the write will be committed, the update will be committed only if the majority of the ensemble are able to replicate it properly. So if it is not responding properly, if the machines are not responding properly, or if it is taking time to respond, the write operation will take more time. So it will actually badly affect the performance. So if you go with the scalability, the problem is the performance. Performance means the speed. So it will be
a problem, because this voting that like the number of machines who votes increases, the number of machine who keeps the file system replica increases. So for just to increase the number of client connectivity, if we increase the number of zookeeper nodes, means voter nodes. So voter nodes are actually the real nodes actually who are like the real members of zookeeper, means who has actually full rights for voting and who decides actually the like decisions made in the decisions happened in the zookeeper. So if we increase the number of nodes in that way, it will affect actually the performance and all seriously. So in that case, what zookeeper like people introduced is that they introduced a new node called observer nodes. So observer nodes actually they made like, these are actually just, it will work like a follower, but the thing is this no voting rights. It's a non-critical node. So like if a follower fails, it will affect the system. But if an observer, since it is actually no, it doesn't have actually any voting rights, it is actually non-critical node. But again, still the client can communicate to the observer node. So this will be, the observer node will be one node among the cluster, but it will not be having any voting rights. So since it doesn't have any voting rights, it will be non-critical node, because it will not take part in any of the decisions made in the zookeeper cluster. So it will simply act as the like interface between the client and the remaining zookeeper clusters. So we can have n number of nodes as we can keep n number of nodes as observer nodes in the cluster. So like it will actually increase the scalability from a client connectivity perspective. So that like, suppose if you add some, if you want to add some more observer nodes, I can add actually observer nodes. I added one more here. So clients can actually connect to this node. So new client. So it can communicate to this observer nodes, and observer node again it will communicate to the observer node, again it will communicate to the leader. Observer will communicate to the leader. Client will communicate to observer. So it will just act like, it will still work like a follower. Only thing is it doesn't have voting rights, so it will not take part in any of the critical decisions made by the zookeeper cluster. It's a non-critical node, because if it fails also, no issues with the cluster. Even if actually one of the observer node fails, nothing will happen to the zookeeper cluster. So everything, the node failure, the everything actually it is decided by the followers and the leader. It will be actually an observer, so it is a non-voting node actually. So this is actually, so now we have actually, if you categorize the machine, since inside a zookeeper cluster we have leader, we have followers, we have observers. So observer is actually the node that I discussed while discussing the leader and followers. I told you there will be one more set of nodes that will be actually present in the cluster other than leader and followers. So those are actually observers. So another thing, actually observers are not mandatory, it's an optional thing. So if you want, we can keep it, otherwise it's an optional thing. Observers are actually optional nodes. Observers are optional nodes. So now I think like we have actually like a good idea about the architecture of the zookeeper. So with this image actually, at least like we'll be having a good idea about the architecture of the zookeeper. So I'll just revise the contents that we discussed till now. So what we discussed, like challenges, challenges of distributed system. Distributed system, then need for zookeeper. Like what is zookeeper? Then what is inside the zookeeper? So we discuss like it is a file system. So zookeeper keeps a file system and which replicates the file system across the nodes. And we discussed about standalone modes of zookeeper, standalone and replicated. So we call the replicated cluster. The clustered mode is called a zookeeper cluster is called ensemble. And we have the zookeeper. It actually replicates the files across all the nodes. So it uses actually a protocol called ZAB, and ZAB actually internally has two phases. One is leader election and atomic broadcast. And again ZAB uses like leader election and atomic broadcast. And in zookeeper cluster actually we have leader, follower and observer. We have three kinds of nodes. Observer is actually optional. And then we discuss like about the number of the criteria used for deciding the number of nodes, like how many node cluster can withstand how much failures, all those things we discussed. Deciding number of nodes and calculating failover capability. So till this point we discussed these things. Then again like we discussed like Z nodes. This was actually discussed previously along with the file system part. Actually we discussed zookeeper. The file system is just like a tree structure. Zookeeper, it's a So zookeeper actually keeps a tree structure, maintains a tree structure. It maintains a tree structure in the file system, and it uses like a Linux kind of Unix like file system. File system, and the nodes will be like known as Z nodes. The members in the tree structure are called Z nodes. We call as Z nodes, and each Z node can store. Z node will be associated with the data. Store data and the default limit is, maximum limit is 1 MB. Default maximum limit that an Z node can store is actually 1 MB. Till this point actually we discussed. So when we discuss more about this Z node, so I said like it can actually have file system like it will be Unix like file system. Suppose like Unix like file system means this is, we will actually create like slash, and here we are creating slash animal slash bird. So we put like slash and inside slash root we divided like two things we created, slash animal and root animal and slash bird. Inside slash bird we are creating again subdivisions like slash animal slash sheep slash animal slash cat. Here I am giving slash bird slash parrot slash bird slash pigeon. So this will be the subcharacter arrays of animal and bird. So it will be maintaining a tree structure. So this is actually just an explanation like how the zookeeper file system works. So this will be like each node will be the ESET node. We call as each node ESET node, and each can be associated with some data. So this is one ESET node, this is one ESET node, this is one ESET node, this is one node. So and each can store some data. So the maximum data it can be stored is like 1 MB, and each can have child nodes also. This animal it has actually two child nodes, cat and sheep. This bird it has two, bird and like parrot and pigeon. Like that it can have child nodes also. So broadly speaking, like if you categorize the ESET nodes, we can have two types of ESET nodes. One is ephemeral ESET nodes, another is persistent ESET nodes. We have two types of ESET nodes. One is ephemeral ESET nodes, another is persistent ESET nodes. So ephemeral ESET node means if a client connects to the zookeeper server and if it creates an ESET node, if a client creates an ESET node, the ESET node will be like the validity of the ESET node, or the ESET node will exist till the client connection or the session exists. So once the client disconnects from the client disconnects, the node will be deleted. So this will be alive till the client that created this node is in state. So once client disconnects, once the client disconnects, the node will be, ESET node will be deleted. So this ephemeral nodes actually, these are actually like good for some particular use cases. So this will be like, this node will be like this node will be kept or preserved till the client that created this node, ESET node, is in the connected state. If it is disconnected or if the session closes, so the at that time the ESET node also will get automatically deleted. So that is actually ephemeral ESET node. Suppose for example if parrot is actually an ephemeral ESET node, suppose if the client connected, the client disconnects, so one client actually connected and created parrot. One client connected and created parrot. So if client disconnects, means parrot will be deleted. Client connected, that time parrot is alive, but if the client disconnects, means again parrot will be deleted. Client alive means parrot is available, like that it will be deleted. So that is the case with ephemeral nodes. Persistent nodes means, persistent node means like it will not be deleted actually if the client who created gets disconnected. So it will be persistent inside the zookeeper cluster. So this will be permanently persistent. This will be persisted in the file system. This will be persisted in the file system and this will not be deleted. Automatically. This will not be deleted automatically. This will be persisted in the file system and this will not be deleted automatically. So this can be deleted or this will be deleted only if any client. Only if any client requests for a deletion. So this persistent nodes, it will not be deleted automatically, but it will be deleted only if any of the clients request for a deletion. And this any client who has access to this reset node can delete that. It's not like actually the client who created this reset node can delete this. It is like any client who can access or who has actually access. This access is defined using the access control list. So any client who has access to this reset node can delete this persistent node. So it will not be deleted automatically. So that is the difference between persistent and formal reset nodes.
So one thing that you should note is this contents of an reset node can't be appended anything. You can't actually append anything to an existing content of a reset node. You can replace it, but you can't actually append it. So every transaction or every modification inside a zookeeper will be tracked using a transaction ID. So all these modifications, actually everything will be tracked using a transaction ID, and that the updates or modification happened in this reset node, it is versioned also. So if you modify something, suppose animal/cat, initially it was cat, then you modified it to dog. I'll make the change. So this is actually version number, version 0, version 1. So this will be the version first. So this will be the second version. Initially it was the first version. This will be the second version. It will get updated. So it will keep a track of the versions also. So this is actually something about the file system of the zookeeper. Then the next thing is the operations that we do with the file system of the zookeeper. There are actually limited set of operations only. So using that only we are achieving the entire synchronization and the coordination. So the operations, I will show you. So these are actually the set of operations that are supported inside zookeeper. So these are one is create. So these are create is there, delete is there. So create will create an reset node, delete will delete an reset node. So delete will delete an reset node. Then exist, it will check whether an reset node exists or not. Then another is get ACL, it will get the access control list associated with an reset node. So set ACL, it's another command, it will set an ACL to the reset node. Then another is get children. So it will get the list of child nodes associated with an reset node. And get data, it will get the data associated with an reset node. Set data, similarly it will set the data associated, it will set the data associated with the reset node. Sync, it synchronizes the client's view of reset node with the zookeeper. So these are actually the 9 basic operations in zookeeper. So we'll be from the client, we'll be doing actually any of these 9 operations. So we have actually different ways to access zookeeper. So one is actually either save 7 So we have so different ways to access ZooKeeper. So these are the 9 operations associated with ZooKeeper. That is the first thing. Then we have different ways to access ZooKeeper. So one is actually through command line. We have a ZooKeeper command line. One is through command line, another is through programs, through API. So we have Java API, we have C, Python, etc. We have several programming language APIs for accessing ZooKeeper. Java, Python, Z, etc. We have several programming languages. So today we'll be like, I'll be showing the command line as well as the API based access to the ZooKeeper. I'll show you in the remaining session. So we'll be doing like, we can do this 9 operations through command line using programs also. So before that, actually we will set up a small ZooKeeper setup. So it will be like, since we have actually like only one node, so I'll be setting up a standalone ZooKeeper instance. So so there actually we can like all these operations we can do with standalone as well as the clustered mode also, but it will be same. Even if you do it with clustered mode also, the operations will be same. So we can, for since we have only, we are actually like the training in the training corpus, we'll do it in the standalone mode because we can achieve the ZooKeeper setup in a single machine. So you can install ZooKeeper in Windows also. The ZooKeeper tarball actually it works with Windows as well as Linux. So I am actually like going to install this in a Linux machine. So I'll show you the steps how to install the ZooKeeper in a Linux machine. So I'll just, before going to that, I'll just show you what are the steps, basic steps. So for installing a ZooKeeper in standalone mode, first we have to download the tarball from the website, ZooKeeper website. Then we have to extract the tarball. Then we have to prepare a configuration file. Then we have to start the ZooKeeper. So first we have to download, we have to extract the tarball, then we have to prepare the configuration file, and we have to start the ZooKeeper. These are the steps that we have to follow for installing a So ZooKeeper can be downloaded from the ZooKeeper website. So I just reached, this is actually the ZooKeeper website. So we can download the latest stable release. So this one's stable releases. So this is actually the latest, like this is stable release. So I'm downloading this 3.4.6 tarball. So we have the command line open here. I'll increase the font size also. Then settings, appearance, change to 12 will be fine. Yeah. And color, I am making it to white, so that will be visible for you. Yeah. So I copied the URL. So here, this is the ZooKeeper tarball. Right click, copy link as. Then reached here. So I'm in a directory like this. It can be in any directory. That is fine. So I'm downloading, this is actually the standalone mode. So I'm downloading the tarball. So wget is the command to download the a file in Linux from the Linux command line. So I have internet connection in this machine, that is why I'm downloading directly. If you don't have internet connection, you download it manually and copy it to this machine using WinSCP. So it got downloaded. It was somewhere around like 16.8 MB. It is somewhere near 17 MB. So now I have a tarball here. So this is the ZooKeeper tarball. So I'm extracting tar-xvf. This is the command, ZooKeeper tarball. It is getting extracted. So it got extracted. So now if I type ls-all, should ideally come yes. So it got extracted, and the ZooKeeper 3.4.6 folder came. So I'm going inside that ZooKeeper folder. So now I can see a lot of contents inside this. So there will be a conf folder and bin folder. This conf folder contains the configuration file. So currently I am in this location, home, easy to user, test zookeeper. So this is actually zookeeper home. We can consider this as zookeeper home. So inside this there is actually conf folder. So I am going inside conf folder. I'm just clearing the screen. Clear. Now screen is clear. Now I am inside conf folder. So now I am inside conf folder / etc user ect user test zookeeper conf. So inside conf there are some contents. So one is actually log4j properties. So anyway, we don't have to touch that. Another is zookeeper sample cfg. So this is a sample configuration file for zookeeper. So we can create the actual configuration file using the sample configuration file. So this sample configuration file is just for our reference, how to make the zookeeper configuration file. So this is the contents inside sample configuration file. These are the contents inside sample configuration file. So like one is again the tick time, init limit, sync limit, data dir. So it is data, actually data dir is actually the place where zookeeper is storing the files. So it is actually pointed to /temp/zookeeper. So in a normal real case, don't put it to /temp directory because it will be cleared actually. So here actually we are just going for doing some sample examples. So that's why like we don't need actually this directory, a proper directory. So let it be like /temp/zookeeper, but in real case don't keep it in /temp directory. We have to change it. If you want to change anything, you can change it. Then client port is actually the port where the clients connect to the zookeeper, that is 2181. Then maximum client connections. So this is actually the number of concurrent connections that a zookeeper can handle. So by default it is 60. If you want more, we can increase that. So like all the properties of the zookeeper actually will be kept here actually. So purge interval, auto purge interval means like it will actually create the snapshots and it will be purged actually. So purged at various intervals. So all those purge settings, everything actually we will keep it here actually. So because if you have to enable this purging and all, otherwise like the zookeeper storage will keep on increasing. So those things actually, these are actually some admin configurations actually, purging and all. But all the configurations, this is actually just like a Java properties file. It is a Java properties file, just like a Java properties file. So we saw like it is zoo_sample.cfg. This will not be read actually. This is just a sample. So for making a proper configuration file, copy this file and paste it a new content, zoo.cfg. The configuration file name should be zoo.cfg. This is the configuration file name. So I copy it. So now we have zoo.cfg. So this will be the configuration file. So we are okay with actually the data directory /temp/zookeeper because we are not going to run more than, like we are just doing it for just the training purpose. So this is fine. Now we are going out of this conf folder, then go inside bin directory. So now we are inside bin directory. Now we can see like lot of options like CLI, cleanup, CLI.cmd, CLI.sh, because we can use this in Windows as well as Linux environments. So if you are using Windows environment, you can use the CMD scripts. If you are using Linux environment, you can use the SH shell scripts. So now we are going to start this zookeeper. So for starting, we can use this zkserver.sh. So what we have to do is we just have to execute this zkserver.sh. Then we have to put the command start. So see, it shows actually it is using the configuration file, whatever we put, this bin dot dot conf zoo.conf, and it is starting. It got started. So here in the configuration file we mentioned it will be the client port will be client connection port will be 2181. So we will see, we will check whether it is running or not. So we will check for the 2181 port, 2181. So see, something is running in this listening at 2181 port. So that is zookeeper. So if we check the status zkserver.sh status, we can see it is standalone. it is in a standalone mode. We are not running in a replicated mode. Since we are running in a standalone mode, it will store standalone status. It is running and it is in standalone mode. Fine. So this is now our zookeeper is up. Now we can actually check with some commands. We can try some commands in the zookeeper command line. So for entering into zookeeper command line, so if you check here, we have actually zk cli.sh. For entering into zookeeper command line, we can execute zk cli.sh. You can simply execute this. It will get inside this zookeeper client. So for connecting, so for getting the options of commands in the zookeeper command line, just type tap actually the tab button twice. You will get actually the commands in the zookeeper command line. So these are the valid commands that can be applied, like used in this zookeeper command line. So if you want to connect to a zookeeper node, we can connect like connect. So right now I can put localhost. The current node is actually zookeeper is running in the same node, so I can put localhost and it is running in 2181. So connect to this zookeeper localhost, which is running in the same host, localhost and 2181. So this one actually will connect to the localhost 2181. So ls, so here you can see ls is there. Ls will list in Linux, ls will list the the file system. So see here also we discuss if it is connected here, it will show connected. Otherwise it won't show connected. Actually it will show not connected. So in ls, if you type in Linux, it will show you the directories. Similarly here also I am putting ls and I have to specify the path ls/. So here it is showing sbase and zookeeper. It is showing two, sbase and zookeeper. So here actually we have sbase running. So that is why it is showing sbase and zookeeper. So if you don't have an sbase cluster running, actually it will not show sbase. It will only show zookeeper. So here, since we have an sbase cluster, this is actually I installed it in a machine which is a Hadoop cluster. So that is the reason actually it is showing HBase. Otherwise it won't show HBase. So I want to create actually something my own. I am creating /test with a data sample data. I am creating an inode /test with the data sample data. I am creating like this. So if it is successfully created, it will show created /test. Now if I put a ls/, it will show me the test. I have test, I have sbase, I have zookeeper. So one is a node got created /test actually. So then if you want to get the details inside /test, what we'll do, we have the command get /test. It will give you the details about /test. So here it gave me the data sample data. So I put the data associated with the /test as sample data. So here also when I put get /test, it gave me the data associated with the z node sample data. And the ZX ID is actually the transaction IDs. The ZX ID is the transaction ID. Then it shows data length, actually it shows the data length. Then the version, actually this is actually the version is first one. We didn't modify this actually. That is why actually it is showing data version 0. So if I do a modification set, so right now I'm again modifying it. Sample, I am putting /test. Modified data. So this is actually the first one I created the /test. Second one I am just updating, not updating means it's not appending, I am just rewriting the contents with something else, modified data. So I modified the data. Now what happened? Now if I get slash test, I'll be getting the contents, modified data, and the transaction ID, it got changed, it got increased, and version, data version, previously it was 0, now it is 1. So the previously the data version was 0, now it is 1 because the version changed because I changed the EtherNode slash test, contents of the EtherNode slash test, it went through a portion of like a process of updated the data. I rewrote, so the version changed, it updated to 1. Then data length, modified length, it's MODIFIED, modified data, it is of 12, so that is why it is showing data length 12. Number of children, so since this test doesn't have any children, child nodes, it will show number of children equal to 0. I am going to create a child node for test, create slash test slash child 1, and with the data, child data, now test 1, test slash child 1 got created. Now if I do is get slash test, I can see number of children 1. I'll get actually number of children 1. And if I do ls slash test slash, sorry, I can end it with a slash. If I do an ls slash test, it will give me child 1 because there is a child inside the EtherNode test. And I am going to create one more EtherNode child node, child 2. I am putting child with the data, child 2 data. Now created child 2 also. Now if I put ls slash test, it will give me 2, child 1 and child 2. And get slash test, it will show me 2 child nodes, number of children 2, and data associated with the ls test is actually modified data, and slash child 2 data, no, child 2, ls slash child 2, no, get slash test slash child 2, it will be child 2 data, it doesn't have any children, so it will show like that. And this is actually in the 0th version, means it is actually in the fresh case, so it is ZX version will be 0. Then like M time is actually the modified time, since actually the creation time, so C time is actually the creation time, and M time is actually the modification time. So C is EtherXID is actually creation transaction ID, M is actually the modified transaction ID. So since actually we create this child 2 is actually freshly created, it will be same. If we modify something, see here in this case of test slash test, we modified slash test several times, that is why the C time and the M time are different, because it got modified at 1842 and the transaction IDs are also different, but in case of this the transaction IDs are same. That is the reason. This is actually the way we checked how to perform this set also. So similarly we can do set, get, all those things. So all these commands we can do. Then we can do all these commands from the zookeeper command line. If you want to quit from the command line, you have to press quit. It will quit from the command line. So this is actually the client session, it got over. So this is actually the way we interact with, this is one way of interacting with zookeeper. So the client connection got over. So I'll show you one more thing, how to delete actually. So zk cli.sh, all these things are actually given in your the assignments. So all these commands actually you can practice. There are only few commands like just create, closed, all those things. So that actually you can practice from your assignments. So ls slash test. So I have actually ls under slash test. I have child 1 and child 2. I am going to delete child 1. Now if I do ls slash test, I'll get only child 2 because child 1 got deleted. If I do delete child 2 also, then after that if I type ls slash test, I'll not be able to see anything, it is empty. All the child nodes of slash test is not got deleted. So this is actually the delete command. Similarly, you can practice all the commands. I'll actually give you the assignments for all the commands. The examples for all the commands in the assignments. This is actually the one way of connecting to Zookeeper through command line. So another way is actually through API. It is actually programmatic. So I'll show you actually very very simple way to access Zookeeper through API. So that is through Python programming. So we can use Java or Python, any programming language. So since actually for simplicity, I am using actually Python programming because it is very easy to explain. That is the reason. Very easy to explain means it is very easy for you to understand actually how we are actually interacting with Zookeeper through Python program. So for just like Java, in Java we use jar file. So similar to that, Python also we use Python libraries for interacting with some particular different set of applications. So for interacting with Zookeeper, we need a Python library called Kazoo. For interacting with Zookeeper, we need a Python library called Kazoo. So the command to install a Python library through the command line is pip install Kazoo. This is just like actually yum install. In Linux and all, we install using the packages using yum install, package name apt-get. In Ubuntu we use apt-get. In CentOS, apt-get install this one package name. So in CentOS we use CentOS, or Red Hat we use yum install. Just like that, for installing the Python packages we use either easy install or pip install. So I'm going to install the Python library for Zookeeper. It is Kazoo only, so I'm going to install that Kazoo. So it got installed. Now if I type Python, I'll show you the program first. So this is actually a simple Python program. So first, for just verifying whether the installation is proper, we will just try importing this classes in this Python. So type Python, then just do the import, just like from kazoo.client import kazoo client. If this import is properly working, it means it is properly working because it didn't throw any error. If it is throwing an error, means the Kazoo client was not properly installed. This is the way to test that. And another thing, if you don't have internet connection, pip install Kazoo will not work. In that case, what you have to do is you have to go to Python. So you have to go to internet, go to this Kazoo, this website pp.python.org Kazoo. Search in Google for Kazoo, then you will get actually this downloads, and in the downloads actually you can see, so this is actually the Python Kazoo website. Downloads, go to downloads, you can see the tarball. So download from here, download the tarball and install. So in this way you can install, download manually and install this library, Kazoo library. So this is just a demo. So if you want, for accessing through programmatic way, you can access otherwise actually like you can follow the command line activity, because mostly actually you will be like you will be the end user as a zookeeper. You will not be going to use this, like if you are really developing any application, distributed application, then only you will be directly using zookeeper. Otherwise the applications that you use like the HPace, Storm, all those things are internally using zookeeper. So just for understanding their working, we are explaining the zookeeper here. So if you really want to write programs, you can download this and install this and try out this. So I'll show you a simple program. So this one, first we are importing the class client, then we are creating a connection, ZK client equal to Cassive client, and this should be the zookeeper host and this should be the zookeeper port. So we are making a client connection and we are just putting the initiating the client connection in these lines. So next thing is we are just creating, actually going to create a path, and we are associating a data to the path. So just like previously we created slash test, similarly we are going to create sample path and we are associating a data created base path. And here actually we are getting, so just similar to the get command, we have actually the API wise get command. So this is actually the way to get the data from details from this sample path. So this is actually the ZK node and this is actually the command. So we got, actually we will get a list. So first one will be data, second one will be the stat. So and we are printing the details here. So we will be printing actually the version and we will be printing the data, version comma data. So once you execute it again, the version will increase. So this is just a sample program. I'll show you one more program. I'll show you how to execute this program. So we can execute the code. So I'm just copying the code and like here I'm creating a file zookeeper api.py. It's a Python program, so api.py I'm creating. So this will be the program. I just pasted that. So be careful, like Python actually programs, we have to keep the intents properly. So since here actually like it should, the indentation should be proper, otherwise actually you will get indentation error. So first one will be like it will be connecting to the client, connecting to the zookeeper, then starting the client connection, then it will be creating sample path and it will associate created base path data. This will be like, it's not a comment actually, I'll change this. I'll put it to sample data, and this will be printing the data and the version. The third line, the last two lines will be, this will be the get command. This is actually the get command, the client dot get the path, then it will print the version and the data associated with that. So we'll see how it happens. First we'll actually just create it, we'll not print it actually. So we will comment these two lines. So we commented those two lines. So this is like hash is actually for commenting that. So in this case it will only create that path. So I'll open one more session so that like we can check it manually. I opened one more thing. So just test zookeeper bin. So I am opening ZK live.sh. It's already connected, just showing actually because it's already showing connected. 81. Okay, so ls/. Now we have only test HBase and zookeeper. I am going to execute this program. Zookeeper. So it got executed. Now we'll see here actually what is there. ls/. So now we have the sample path, test HBase, zookeeper, all those things actually it got created here. We have all these things here. So sample path also got created. Now we will uncomment this, the last two part, and we will comment the create part, because if you are not commenting the create part, it will try to create again the same path and it will throw error the path already exist. Now we will just execute. So the intention is like, it will display the data associated with this path and it will show the version. So it will show version 0, data is sample data. This is what we passed actually, sample data. Version is 0, data is sample data. This is same as the zookeeper get command. So from command line also we will do the same thing. Get slash sample data. So sorry, it is sample path, it's not sample data, sample path. Get slash sample path. So here the data is sample data, version is 0. So this is similarly, we can create actually another path. We'll execute it together. So sample path 1, path 1, and list sample path 1. Or else instead of creating it, we'll update it. Set, instead of, we already have sample path, so we are updated, like new sample data, new data. I'm putting, I'm changing the value of sample path to new data. We'll see what happens. So now it will print version, actually it became 1 because we modified it, and data is new data. So from command line also we will see the same thing. Get sample path, it became, the data is new data, and here we can see C time and M time, it got changed. M time it is 99, C time is this one 197, and data version it became 1, it got modified. Now we will do thing, we will delete it. It's a client dot delete path. Execute it. Now here if you type get sample path, it should throw error. Does not exist sample path, because we deleted that. If you type ls slash, you'll not be able to see sample path because we deleted the sample path. So this is actually a very simple program using Python. So lastly, like the end, actually what I did was I just did a delete then the path, that is the reason. That, so I'll show you one more program. So this is actually almost same program only, but it has actually some modifications. I'll explain it. So Nano Zookeeper API 2, I'm creating new file, Zookeeper API 2. So this is the new program, I'll explain one by one. So first line is importing actually the Cazoo client. Second line, we are creating the Zookeeper client, Cazoo client, and host actually we put, so here we can put comma separated hosts. So since this is a standalone application, Zookeeper, we have only one host. If you have a number of hosts, we can put comma separated hosts. So we are connecting to the Zookeeper and we are starting the client. So here the client starts, client connection starts. Here we are checking actually whether the slash training is at not exist. So this will return true if it is existing, and it will return false if it is not existing. So if ZK client exists slash training, if it is true means it exists, if it is false means it is not existing. If it is false means if it is not existing, then create training. and I am actually adding a data called created base path. So this will create actually the slash training is a node if it is not existing. That is the first line. This if condition performs this part. Then next thing is zk client dot ensure path. So what this ensure path will do is it will check whether this path exists in the zookeeper. If it is existing, it will not do anything. If it is not existing, it will create that path. So if it is existing, it will not do, but it will not create anything. But if it is existing, it will create that path initial value, and if it is, it will create that and it will populate the initial value. So this is actually the data associated with that. I am putting initial with the data initial value. Then the third of, again this line we know actually how to get the data and version. This line printing, this one actually we are printing the data, and zk client dot set. Set means I am again setting actually the value. Previously initially I gave a value called initial value. Now I am giving a value updated value. So again we are printing the value for training Hadoop. So first we will print the data associated to training Hadoop. Again we will print the data associated to the training Hadoop. So this is a simple thing. Here we are doing some checks whether the path exists. Even if the path exists, actually here this program will not throw any error. The other program will throw error because we were simply creating the path without any checks. This program will not create any issues even if you run a number of times. So before executing, this is actually zookeeper API 2. The previous program was zookeeper API 1. So we will open the first program again and I will show you what happens if we run it several times. So I uncommented this one. I uncommented this program. Delete part actually I am deleting. So yeah, fine. So this one actually instead of set, I am going to do create. This is the first program. So we'll see what happens if I run this program twice. So this is the program, first program. So I'll run this. I am going to run this program twice. API, sorry, zookeeper API.py. Python zookeeper API.py. It created actually version 1. And if I run again, I'll get an error. It shows actually node already exists error, because in the program, if you read the program, you can see it is simply creating the path without doing any check. So in the second program, we are overcoming this issue. So if I execute the second program, zookeeper API 2.py, so it is showing ACL. Okay, it has actually like some exception in the program. So we have to fix that exception. We'll check that. Zookeeper API 2.py. What is the problem? Ensure path train. Is false. Created base path. So like it was giving error because the ensure path we gave, I gave actually the data also. So I gave actually the data also along with the ensure path. The ensure path will not accept data. It will actually will be able to like give the data location path. It will check whether the path exists or not. If it is existing, it will not do anything. If it is not existing, it will create it. We can set ACLs using this, but we will not be able to set any data using this. Then, so we'll execute this Python API 2.py executed. So version 1 data, version 0 data. It was nothing, but because we simply created. Version 0 was created actually by this one, ensure path. So we didn't actually add any data there. That's why in version 0 there was no data, but version 1 we put updated data, updated value. In version 1 we put the updated value that got printed here. So that is, so here if you come here, if you type ls slash, you can see training also got created. So ls slash training, ideally the Hadoop should be there. Yeah, Hadoop also there. Get slash training, this is the command line, so we are just verifying it. So slash training, no data because we didn't add any data. Number of children is 1. Gets Hadoop, we have updated value, number of children 0, data length this much. So if I execute this again, ideally it should not throw any error. It okay. So this one is ZK client not defined, some spelling mistake happened I think. Yeah, I just copy pasted something wrong, shit. This is fine. So because that was a spelling mistake, I just pasted something wrongly. See, if I execute this thing again and again, the version number keep on increasing. 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4. If I execute again also, it will not throw any error because I'm just verifying. I'm checking actually whether that path exists. If it is not existing, then only I am creating. That is. So the version number, version keep on changing. You can see the version keep on changing for every execution. So this is actually one way of, another way of actually accessing the zookeeper. So this one I showed using Python program. Similarly, we can perform the same things using Java and like C and other programming languages actually. So with this, we covered almost like all the topics in the zookeeper. So so I'll be attaching an assignment section along with this study material, so you can go through that and you can try out all these things, and like if you face any issues or any problems, you can get back to me. Okay, thank you.